Well, it's now past 8 o'clock. One of my favourite birding sights of all time is watching a flock of African grey parrots wheel and squawk above the canopy of the rainforest in the Central African Republic. And I absolutely loathe seeing African greys and indeed other parrots in cages. I know it's something that gives a lot of people a lot of pleasure. I know a lot of people make money from breeding these birds in captivity, but I think African greys and other parrots should be free. And I saw an email earlier this week which had a couple of photographs in that just made me mad. Crates filled with African greys, green droppings, 48 dead, the rest dehydrated, starving and very stressed. Dr. Steve Boys is director of the World Parrot Trust Africa on the line to us from Cape St. Francis. Morning, Steve.
Morning, John.
What was the occasion of those photographs being taken?
Those were birds coming into the Limbe Sanctuary in Cameroon, just basically in the armpit of Africa there. They were on their way to Nigeria, where they would subsequently either be illegally shipped into Europe or sent to the Far East or Middle East, where we have some emerging markets for those birds.
Yes, talking to a couple of people in South Africa, they tell me that they're pretty certain that they only get their African greys from stuff which has been bred in captivity, and that their having an African grey is making no impact on the wild population.
Well, absolutely. I mean, there are people breeding African greys in South Africa, but the problem is that a lot of the African greys coming in, especially from the DRC, are coming into breeding facilities in South Africa and then almost being laundered as captive bred, so that people in pet stores can say that, and they are, they're being honest, that's what they believe, that often these birds are wild caught. It's just a lot cheaper for the guys to source them that way, and they make a lot more money, obviously.
And they are catching them in places like the DRC and Cameroon and Congo Republic and CAR, where there's very little, if any, law enforcement pertaining to nature.
I mean, we've had a few victories recently with confiscations both in the DRC and in Cameroon. Cameroon actually have a temporary moratorium on the catching and export of African greys. The Tim and I, that's the more endangered of the two African greys that we have in Africa. What happened recently in the DRC was very sad, in the sense that we had our first confiscation by the government department, 500 greys, which we called the Congo 500, and within a month the trader had convinced the ministry to seize them back at gunpoint with serious threats to the people at the sanctuary, and now they're being held again in Kinshasa, being prepared for export. And we think they're coming to South Africa, and we would like to be able to intercept that import.
But the fact that this convincing of the Congolese government was able to happen, the DRC government, suggests that there's an awful lot of money involved in this trade of parrots.
Absolutely. I mean, the margins are spectacular. I mean, the guys are paying $200 for these parrots at the source country and selling them for R2,500 here in South Africa.
That's a fairly decent return on capital, isn't it?
Absolutely.
And, Steve, the threat to the population in the wild, is it a sort of gentle red light flashing quite slowly, or is it a large red light beaming constantly with sirens attendant?
No, there are definitely sirens there. I mean, we've just now separated the two species, so we have a separate African grey in West Africa, which we're now going to classify as endangered, or hopefully, in the next few months, and the ones in the DRC and the Central African Republic and the Congo Republic are now going to be classified as vulnerable. We've seen local extinctions in Kenya, Uganda, Rwanda, areas in the DRC, throughout West Africa. I mean, they've disappeared. It's basically these catches go into a place where the parrots come down to the ground, they put nets out and put snares, these long fishline snares, and catch as many birds as possible until that resource is exhausted, and then they move deeper into the forest. There are colleagues of ours in the DRC that are following this and tracking these local extinctions in these forest patches, and it's very hard for them to keep up with the trappers.
And the recategorization of these two split parrot species, will that make a difference?
It will make a difference. It opens the door to upgrading their threat status to endangered and vulnerable, and then in 2013 we'll be able to get both species hopefully onto CITES Appendix 1, which will ban all international trade and hopefully end this.
Dr. Steve Boys, Director of the World Parrot Trust Africa, on the line to us from Cape St. Francis.